Welcome to the Free Marketeers, the official podcast of the Free Market Foundation.
Good afternoon, listeners. You're listening to a new episode of the Free Marketeers podcast. You're joined by myself, Chris Hutton, Mpiaki Dlamini, a regular, and the debutant, Tebogo. Tebogo, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you.
I think today, listeners, we're going to start off with a new article from the FMF. It was published in City Press today by our executive director, Leon Lowe. It's on the subject of energy, which I think is quite relevant, especially we hear about Eskom's continued troubles and bailouts. We wonder, are we ever going to have, you know, a reliable supply of energy the next few months or years? Bjarke, I think you've read over it. Are there any particular points that stand out to you? Anything you want to tell us about?
Yeah, it was quite interesting, also very technical, which is why I guess Leon was the best person to write about this kind of stuff, because it was all about the new integrated resource plan, the draft IRP released by government. And so basically, Leon said to address 7 myths about renewable power that you see in the IRP. So for example, one of the things he says that people think renewables have the lowest cost power, but it's actually have one of the highest cost of power, because of the way that the calculation is made.
Right,
they use something called the levelized cost of electricity, which is basically trying to look into the future almost and see what electricity will cost in over the lifetime of a power plant. Which is, of course, every time you look at into the future, you have to accept some level of uncertainty, and you have to make a lot of assumptions. So
yeah, anything future oriented has an element of risk.
And so all of those things, and they also made assumptions about the foreign exchange rates, gas prices, and the demand of electricity, which are not necessarily true.
No.
And then, and just on the demand side of it, one of the assumptions, according to Mr. Law, was that they assumed that the current process cycle that we're in now, where the demand for electricity has been falling, will continue. But it's actually not necessarily true, because the only reason that the demand has been falling is because Eskom, because of it has no real competitors, has been failing to keep up with the demand.
So people don't have a choice. They're going to end up using less electricity.
Exactly. So and the electricity prices have risen by 250%.
350.
Yes, since 2008, the 2008 crisis. So if you think about those, obviously, if you just know the supply and demand graph, that's, of course, the price increases, then obviously the demand is going to fall.
Yeah, as with anything,
So it's, it was an interesting article.
Yeah.
And the other justification is they think that it will create jobs.
Yeah.
Renewables will create jobs, which is not necessarily the case, because you could create more jobs, but you can produce less power.
Right.
And then they also use something called job years, which is a stupid thing to do. The example that Leon uses is like, if you have a 200-year-old power plant, and then there are 10 people working in that power plant, then that's equivalent to 2,000 job years. So
sounds very arbitrary.
So you multiply those two numbers, the 10 people multiplied by the number of years the plant has been in operation, and you say no, this plant has created 2,000 job years. So what they say is they think renewables are going to create 114,000 job years.
I think the three of us are in the wrong business. We need to start creating job years. We can just make businesses.
And you know, something that I also read, you know, because they also referring to the National Development Plan, you know, that the Minister of Energy, Jeff Radebe, has to, you know, give the objectives of this whole, you know, according to the National Development Plan. So when I was going through the document, you know, online, is that, you know, the plan is that, you know, they want to ensure that, you know, quality of life for all people in South Africa, and to make sure that, you know, they do a job creation, as MPIC was already saying. But also we have to consider, like, you know, at what cost, you know, are they going to do all these things, you know, at what cost is this all going to be implemented?
I think that's a very good point. We raised the issue of unforeseen circumstances and cost benefit a lot with government. Any government plans, they have this grand vision of all the jobs they're going to create and all this stuff, but then they don't worry about the actual implications.
Exactly.
And you know, also we have to consider that, you know, in terms of the constitution of South Africa, you know, the constitution, one of the founding provision says that South Africa is a democratic state founded on the rule of law. So sometimes the government carries, you know, their objectives, but by not considering, you know, the rule of law imperatives, like, you know, what the rule of law requires, you know. And I think, you know, this whole system actually it might be, you know, even challenged if it's in line with the objectives of the South African Constitution, you know, and the culture of, you know, creating and ensuring that all people prosper, you know, in South Africa. At what cost? That's the big question that when I was reading the articles, I was asking myself, like, okay, at what cost is this whole thing going to be implemented?
Yeah. I think that point of the rule of law is very important. And our colleague who's also on the podcast sometimes, Martin van Staden, he writes a lot about this sort of thing. And then exactly on the specific topic, next week we've got an event at the FMF next week, Wednesday, evening event. Listeners, if you want more information, you can just go onto the website and you can please come and attend, just RSVP and come and join us on Wednesday evening. And it's going to be hosted by Franz Rodenbach and Dan Mitchell. Dan Mitchell from the US, he'll be flying out, coming to talk to us. He writes a lot of articles for Fee, and I think he's got a blog as well, Piaggi. So I think that's the topic broadly. They're going to talk about the rule of law and its impact on freedom.
Actually, the rule of law more than ever now.
Teboho, do you know anything about the event? Do you know anything about the topic that they're going to talk about?
Yeah, well, as you said, you know, the topic actually involves on the principles of the rule of law. Remember that at the FMF, you know, they are the 10 imperatives, you know, that the rule of law board, you know, it actually is created. So I think the speakers and the people who are coming to attend, most of them, they are, because on the website those imperatives are there.
Okay.
They are going to ask, you know, some questions or whether if, you know, most of the government policies, like the current electricity energy one, is in line with the South African rule of law.
Because
rule of law, like, you know, when I was working for the project, law review project, that became the rule of law project now some years ago, there was a big question on many cases or many policies that have been passed by the state that do not comply with the principles of the rule of law. Yeah, you know, like discretionary powers and, you know, abuse of power, separation of powers, where the executive take the role of the judiciary or something like that. So he's going to discuss about, okay, how to understand the rule of law.
And okay.
I think, you know, if people come to attend, really, it will be very, very interesting.
Sounds pretty useful. The rule of law might sound like quite an abstract principle, but if we can apply it to, you know, as you said, different government projects and ideas, how it actually, how that spirit of the rule of law, you know, filters through. So I think that'll be quite good. I'm quite looking forward to that one specifically.
It's one of those most people, including me too. I
don't know if they're gonna have any numbers for you.
That's why I need to know more about those kinds of things, like the rule of law, because
and guess what, you know what, I remember there was a talk last time, you know, I think we had some, you know, it was a launch of some book or the rule of law, official launch by Mervyn King, I think it was last year I attended, you know. And then from there, Leon gave an example by me saying, watch, when I was studying a law degree at the university, in our constitutional law class, my lecturer never mentioned, we never studied something to do with the rule of law. And he said it's such an important principle that, you know, any constitution of a democratic nation actually has to contain the rule of law in their provision. But in South Africa, for example, if you go to most of the legal academics and so on, they don't really go into the rule of law. They can just discuss about the human rights culture and other stuff, but when it comes to the rule of law, I think it's the time that people, they have to understand what the rule of law entails, so that the rule of law actually is something that can prevent even abuse of power, you know, and where politicians, you know, take more power than the power that is not given to them by the legislation. So I think that is a very good opportunity.
I think that's really important what you're saying, especially tied with state capture. One wonders what rule of law can say about that kind of thing. I think it'll be a good event. Okay, just moving on to our last topic, SAA. The finance minister Tito Mboweni, he came out and said that he thinks it should be closed down. As far as I can remember, I read something today that they've already spent, I think the CEO of SAA, the new CEO, he said that they've already spent 3 billion of the 5 billion new bailout that they've got. So they need it. I don't know how much they need just to sort of make up the gap. Never mind, you know, one wonders when they'll ever make a profit, if ever. But we've written quite a bit on SAA and the fact that at this point, the longer you keep it alive, the more and more it costs taxpayers. Piaggi, I think you would probably, you know, I don't want to assume anything, but you'd probably agree that competition would be best for South Africans in terms of airfares and costs sort of thing. SAA, I mean, do you take hope in what the minister said? Do you think it could actually be closed down?
Well, it seems like his cabinet colleagues are resisting him now, because it seems the latest news is that he's been shut down in cabinet. People have their interest, they don't want to close SAA for some strange reason. And we know from what David Root said when he was here at the FMF, the longer we, like you just said now, the longer we keep SAA alive, the more it costs us to close it down. When we do eventually realize, we'll come to grips with economic phases, we need to close it down. and we're just on the point about competition. It should be a no-brainer. Let's like leave these things to the private sector, to competition. Let private industry deal with this, and then you find the most efficient option, for air travel, whether internationally or domestically. So government should be completely shouldn't be involved at all in providing any service. In fact, any service that should be done by the private sector. So I don't see. Yeah, I don't see where this is going, but it looks bad right now because it's going to continue adding more and more debts to the fiscus, and until it gets to bankruptcy, I suppose.
I wonder how long it would take. And I was just thought about the health minister Aaron Motsoaledi. He said that the NHI is sort of on pause because there's no money for it. So at least here and there they realize reality simply is there's no money.
Actually, it's a good
we can only hope that more and more people in parliament and politicians start to realize the economic reality of their plans.
That's true.
And I don't think as a matter of principle, I guess I'm speaking for myself, but I don't have a problem with a national airline as such with a flag on it. You know, there's an element of pride, but it depends on what they're actually doing. You can't be proud of something that keeps on getting bailed out. So I know that they'd like to defend it as our national carrier, but we can't actually be proud of it.
And we have a lot of great domestic companies that could make a great national carrier, the likes of Comair, which has a license from British Airways. So it could also license the use of our national the national flag, for example. So you have a lot of options. You have the companies like it's also part of SAA, but Mango is doing well compared to the rest of SAA. You have a Fly SA Fair, so you have a lot of part of Comair. So like you do have options. Just that the flag thing is just, it doesn't have to be a government thing. You can give it to a private company that's a South African company. They fly with the flag. It's not a big deal.
Even with the job losses, which I know that's probably the biggest concern for people trying to defend it, but if you upskill the people working at SAA and let them compete in the private market, they could probably make much more money well. They could probably earn higher salaries than they do at SAA.
If you're a technician or a traffic controller or anything like that, anything related to flying or all those things, there's an international market for you. So if you're good at your job, you'll definitely find another job. And just on the licensing, the flag thing, this could be a good way for the government to make itself some money, because they could, as one of the directors said, I think it was Terry Markman, I think.
One of our consultants.
So he was being interviewed on ENCA, and the government could be a nice way for the government to make itself some money, license out the flag for a private company to use, and they get a bit of money to treasury. So
we know the government needs money as much as possible. Instead of raising taxes and VAT, maybe.
But you know, it's very interesting, because I mean, in my personal opinion, is that, you know, the whole SSA, you know, is that it seems like the government is avoiding competition with the private sector.
I think that's right.
And where there's no competition, actually, things can't be done in the right way. You know, we need competition so that people can maintain the high quality standards. Right. You know, it seems like, you know, the government is just there to avoid that. You know, they don't want any private sector to compete with them as far as, you know, flights are concerned and so on.
I think that's a very good point. The best way to protect yourself from competition is to just keep the competition out. Okay, listeners, just wrapping up, for your interest, obviously I mentioned the event coming up next week, but on the 20th and 21st of November at the Radisson Blue in Sandton, we've got a conference on expropriation without compensation. We've got an international lineup of speakers. If you'd like to attend, please go to the website and register and come and join us. It's promising to be a very important 2 days. I think next week the Parliamentary Review Committee might deliver their report on the parliamentary hearings and all of that on EWC, so that might influence some of the topics. But I think we've got a broad range. We're going to talk about the current problems, land audits, and as well also the solutions. I think it should be quite informative. Gents, thank you very much for joining me. Listeners, if you want to find us on social media, on Facebook, we are at FMFSA, and on Twitter at FMF South Africa. Please subscribe to our channel on YouTube, like it, and please share it across all of your different social media platforms. And we'll talk to you again next week. Bye.
Bye. Perfect. Guys.
Thank you.
Bye. Thanks.